guys, so this video is all about how to really effectively treat stress fractures. In my experience, it's something that's often done really poorly, and often people will have a stress fracture, they'll have some time off, they'll go back to what they are doing, and it will come back. So I wanted to give you some insights into how to really treat this long term. Now, the first one that we're going to look at is how to get all of the contributing factors. And there are three things within this that I want you to think about. Number one is whether it's an insufficiency fracture or an overload fracture. So an insufficiency fracture often happens if we've got low vitamin D, or our nutrition is not very good, or there's some reason we've got an underlying medical condition where the bone is actually not strong enough for what it's being asked to do. This can happen if there's any disordered eating going on, but we're also noticing high levels of dancers who have very low vitamin D, which is very involved in laying down your bones. So sometimes this can come into play if you're having recurrent stress fractures. The second part in determining why it happens is actually really looking at the mechanics of what you're doing. So I'm going to actually chat about the mechanics of the foot, because a lot of stress fractures happen in the feet, often in your navicular, in your second toe, or up into your tibia. Now, most of these happen due to a restriction in range somewhere, so that when we're landing in a jump, there's not enough shock absorption, or there's not enough hip control, or there's something wrong with the mechanics of what you're actually doing. Now, it takes a very trained eye to be able to watch you move and see where those faults are, and often it's in an area completely unrelated to the foot. So a really interesting example of this was actually a rhythmic gymnast who I started working with in the UK, Lynn, and you can see some of the details of what we talked about with her below. Basically, Lynn had had a recurrent navicular stress fracture, which is this bone right here. She'd had it booted, she'd take some time off training, and it would get better, but every time she went back to training, it would come back. And what happened, I started working with her via Skype, and just by looking at her videos of her walking, we could see that there were some instabilities in her pelvis, but also some restrictions in her midfoot. And if we don't deal with those things, the load continues to go into the area. Now, the second key point that I really want to hone in on is do not ice your stress fracture for extended periods of time. Now, this is really interesting because a lot of people have been told, oh, if it's sore, put ice on it. But we really need to think about the physiological consequences of this. Often stress fractures happen because there's not enough blood flow into that area, or not enough strength in that bone in the first place. If you ice it, you're actually shutting down all those little capillaries and you get less blood flow into that area. So you may actually be delaying the healing rather than improving it. What I suggest instead is doing contrast bathing, which is where you use a hot, warm water bath, and then a cool one, and a warm one, and a cool one, to dilate and constrict and dilate and constrict those blood vessels to actually force new blood flow in to really help with the healing. There has been a lot of research recently on the validity of icing, and our approach has really drastically changed. So in order to learn a little bit more about this, I suggest you look at the Be Calm protocol, which was developed by some therapists in Canada. They've done some amazing work of actually looking at the research. So I really encourage anyone who is using icing to read that article and look at the most updated information on what is suggested in regards to injuries and icing. Now, the third part in dealing with stress fractures is really getting a comprehensive rehab program from a really well-trained, qualified therapist. This is super important. Within this rehab program, we want to be correcting all the contributing factors to that injury. As we talked about in stage one, this may include mobilization techniques for your foot. It may include core stability exercises, balance retraining, all kinds of things, and those things will be particular to you. It's not a one program fixes everything, so it's not one that we can really go, this is the solution for a navicular stress fracture, because everyone's kind of strategy for coping with their weaknesses is a little bit different. Number two is relative rest, and this is something that a lot of people don't do enough of. Relative rest is not putting your foot in a boot and not loading it for 6 weeks. We need to make sure that we are resting the structures enough to let them heal. However, especially in the case of stress fractures, it is important that we have graded loading as we start building back. We need to make sure that we are actually putting a little bit of load through that bone in order for the strength to rebuild. If we take the load completely off it, then often the bone will go, oh, I don't need to do anything, I can just rest and not heal. We need to have very strategic load, starting off at very low levels and building up as the trabecular, as the kind of the fibers within that bone stiffen up and strengthen up. The other thing is making sure that you keep up with all the rest of your training. And this is where the Will I Bounce Game program comes in, and it's really handy to keep training your stability, your turnout, your mobility, all the other coordination that you need in class, and guiding through from a floor bar to, if you are in a boot, bar you can do in a boot, through to what you can do in the jumps part of class and in the turns part of class without actually loading the foot anything more than it needs to be. So as a summary, if we're thinking about stress fractures, what you want to do, think of all of the contributing factors and really get some help in identifying those. Number two, don't ice it aggressively. Contrast bathing is okay to drive new blood flow into there, but please don't ice it as it may delay your healing. And number three, make sure you have a really comprehensive rehab program with a qualified therapist that's going to guide you through both the treatment of the fracture itself and keeping the rest of your body fully functioning. I hope that's been interesting. Let us know your thoughts, and I look forward to hearing from you soon.